ladies. Ladies and gentlemen.
Bonnie?
It's going right at your chin.
Okay.
Ladies and gentlemen, if I could have your attention for a moment, please. We're delighted to see so many of you out tonight. I'm getting a signal here. Okay. We're delighted to see so many of you out tonight. And I know that your reason for coming is to hear our guest speaker. I would just like to say first and foremost that these lecture series have been made available because of many of you people here. They were made possible by friends of the University of Lethbridge, by friends of the late Dr. Alec Johnson, and of course the Lethbridge Historical Society. The three groups together have put together a $25,000 endowment trust fund in honor of the late Dr. Alec Johnson. The interest from this fund enables us to invite distinguished speakers to come to speak to us once a year on any topics that were dear to the heart of the late Dr. Alec Johnson. Those topics are often on agriculture, geology, archaeology, and things that were of historical importance to this area, part of the province. As many of you know, Dr. Johnson was born in Saskatchewan in a small rural community, was educated at the University of Saskatoon and then in Bozeman. He had a keen interest in the history of our city. He was a research scientist at the research station and was well recognized by his peers. He was elected to the Fellow of the Agriculture Institute of Canada. He was elected Fellow of the Society for Range Management. And in 1973, the local Kainai chieftainship was awarded to him. He was a great author and wrote many articles. The two best known books that he wrote was Lethbridge, A Centennial History, 1985, Lethbridge, Its Coal and Industry. The university always recognized people who have served their community in some unprecedented way and then awarded the late Dr. Alec Johnson an honorary degree. Shortly after that, he received the prestigious Alberta Order of Excellence. This gentleman was truly an example for many of us, and I know that we are delighted that his work can continue through speeches and lectures that are made possible from this endowment fund. And I would like to call on Margaret Kennedy at this time to introduce our guest tonight, and I know that that is the person you are really here to hear. So with no further delay, Margaret Kennedy, please.
Well, I too would like to welcome all of you here. It's a wonderful turnout to hear Dr. Reeves speak. And we can say truly tonight that neither rain nor snow nor dark of night nor car accidents have kept our guest speaker from arriving here tonight. The trip from Calgary to Lethbridge had a few unwelcome surprises in it for our guest speaker, so we're doubly fortunate to have him here tonight, safe and sound. It's particularly appropriate to have Dr. Brian Reeves, or Barney Reeves, as some of you might be more familiar with, as our speaker for the Alec Johnson Memorial Lecture Series. First of all, he and Alec shared a number of interests in Southern Alberta history and communicated with each other on a number of different research projects. Secondly, they have in common the very building in which we so fondly associate Alec, the Galt Museum, where Alec spent most of his time. Dr. Reeves also has a historical connection with that building, as he was one of the last babies born there when it was still the Galt Hospital, just a few short years ago. Barney Reeves is likely no stranger to many of you in the audience who have had any connection with the archaeology of Alberta, the Archaeology Society, or any of the related interests. He has spent most of his lengthy and diverse career working with the archaeology and history of the Northwestern Plains. His master's thesis from University of Calgary in 1967 dealt with the Kenny site, for example, a Bessant campsite located just west of the Pagan Reserve. And this was the first provincially designated archaeological site in the province. His PhD, also from the University of Calgary in 1970, was a summary work of the last 2,500 years of Plains Native occupation of the Northwestern Plains. It has become a classic reference work for people working in the archaeology of this region. The archaeology of southwestern Alberta has also unfolded through other major projects with which Dr. Reeves has been directly associated, such as the first full-scale excavations at Head Smashed in Buffalo Jump, and long-term studies in the Crow's Nest Pass and Waterton National Park. And in fact, many of us involved today in Alberta archaeology got our start in at least one of these projects. It's quite characteristic for Barney to take on research challenges of very large scope and yet bring a coherence to them by skillful recall of seemingly inconsequential facts and by an ability to draw together all these loose threads into a very meaningful synthesis. His work in sorting out the historical literature and oral traditions of the past two centuries dealing with the Blackfoot is the most current example of this synthesis ability. And part of what you'll hear tonight stems from this most recent research. He has taught archaeology at the University of Calgary since 1970. Never content to have only one thing on his plate at a time, he has also been, since 1973, president of Lifeways of Canada Limited, Alberta's oldest archaeological consulting firm. And usually there are several other things in there as well, such as his recent involvement with the Trail of the Great Bear, an educational and tourism marketing venture. In recent years, Dr. Reeves has focused his attention on the landscape with which he is so familiar, the mountains and foothills of southern Alberta and northern Montana. Having been raised in Waterton Park, which is still his home, it is understandable that he would share in the reverence and respect for that wonderful landscape, as do the native people who were its primary occupants. His talk tonight, The Sacred Geography of the Blackfoot, describes the relationship of the people to the land and the role of the many sacred focal points, such as Chief Mountain, the Sweetgrass Hills, Head Smashed In, and other sites, and their relationship to the fundamental revisions experienced so long ago. But then he can tell you about this much better than I can, so please join me in welcoming our guest speaker, Dr. Brian Reeves.
Thank you, Margaret. I had forgotten about the gout. But I do remember having my tonsils out there in 1944 at the age of four. I don't remember being born there, but I do remember the later event. Then I went to the old hospital and had my adenoids out. Our family doctor was Dr. Bigelow, who many of you probably know. My talk tonight, if we'll douse the lights, please, and put up the slides. Okay, there we go. It's a slide trip through this place we all live in. And like any good storyteller, we start with a story. The talk is entitled Blackfoot, or in this case, my old slides, the Pig End, but since the Pig End are one of the three tribes, along with the Kainai and the Tsitsika, the Blackfoot people, this is a common shared tradition. This deals with a subject which is called sacred geography or sacred ecology. It's how people around the world put together sacred space and define it. And this isn't something that happens over a few generations. It takes a great deal of time. So let's start with a story, how the world was created in Blackfoot tradition. In Blackfoot tradition, in the beginning, this place wasn't here. It hadn't been, this place, this landscape where we are today, wasn't here. And in the story, Napi, the creator, walks north. As Napi walks north through this land, he creates the land. Creates the land, he creates the trees, he creates the grass, the flowers, and he creates the animals. And in the beginning, among the many stories that relate to the creation cycle, there's a problem. The buffaloes and the sheep have a lot of trouble, and the antelope, because all these rocks are lying around in the landscape. And Napi says, okay, I'll fix it up. And he takes all the rocks and puts them in a big long line, and that's the backbone, the stachus, the Rocky Mountains. So the buffaloes are happy because they don't jump or don't butt into the rocks, and the sheep and the antelope are happy, particularly the sheep, because they can jump from rock to rock. And that's how it's all put together. Now you might say, and that's what it's like. All along the Rocky Mountains, the traditional Blackfoot territory prior to the coming of the white men into the West extended from the Missouri River or the Big Muddy River on the south to the Big Muddy River on the north, which we call the North Saskatchewan. It was a vast land which extended from the Rocky Mountains east to somewhere east in Saskatchewan and has been their land for thousands of years. You might say this brief accounting of the story is a myth, but it isn't. Just like the Aboriginal people in Australia and the Judeo-Christian people, which most of us are, all our people have traditions of how the world came to be as it is. And in the case of the Australian Aborigines, some of you may know the Australian people talk about dream time, that mythical time when there were giant kangaroos and Australia was a wonderful place. But we know through scientific studies, geology and other studies, that this in fact did exist in Australia. This was 10,000 years before the Ice Age ended, when Australia was a beautiful place. And what I think the Napi story tells us, and has been brought down through countless millennia, is the recreation of this world when the Ice Age left. Because at one time, 14,000, 20,000 years ago, this whole landscape we live in today was covered by ice. The ice left and the lakes left, and the plants and the animals and the people came back. And I think this is what this story tells us. And this story is unique to the Blackfoot. It's not shared with their neighboring tribes such as the Arapaho or the Cheyenne or other peoples. Later, Napi created the people. One of the places he created the people is the Porcupine Hills, Porcupine Mountains. And in the beginning, the people didn't know how to hunt buffaloes. And in some version of the stories, the buffaloes hunted people. In other versions, the people were starving. So they came to Napi and said, well, tell us how to hunt buffalo. And this is a place that's well-remembered in tradition that he taught people how to run buffaloes over cliffs at the buffalo jump. The proper name of this place is Buffalo Jump, not Head Smashed In. After Napi had finished his creation of the world and the people and everything, he left to go and join the up above people. He went up his holy river, the old man's river, this you'll never see again, into the up above. And of course, the traditional people today believe that he is still there among the other up above people and watching over his creation. So what I want to talk to you about is how this sacred geography got put together over thousands of years. Where sacred events happen. The Charlie Russell depiction of Pekani Camp. These are the kinds of images that many of us are used to, traditional images in the past. I'm not talking about something that is historic. This is a living tradition still practiced today among traditional Blackfoot people. Now, many people read books, and unfortunately, these are many of the accounts that we read. George Bird Grinnell's book, published in 1892 originally. George Bird Grinnell is a very important person. He was a conservationist, ethnologist, paleontologist, who fortunately decided not to join Custer in that battle of the Little Bighorn. But he came to Glacier Park early in 1883 and became very instrumental in helping the Blackfeet people in Montana. And he is, in fact, the reason Glacier National Park exists today. He took very good notes. I've read his notes, but he wrote a book. Think about the book, 1892. It's written to a New York, Eastern, middle-class, upper-class literary audience. And what he does in his book is edit what he received from sharing, the elders sharing with him. So the stories are abbreviated. The sense of place, where things happen, the sense of people, who was involved, and the sense of time, when things happen, is largely missing from the book, but not from his notes. Well, that one's not going to drop. But the other book I was going to show you was Walter McClintock's Old North Trail, which is another very edited and biased version. We got a quick announcement here.
I'm sorry to interrupt this lecture, but we have a car that's illegally parked, and if you you don't move your car, you're going to be towed. So this is your warning. It's a silver Ford Tempo. License plate is M as in Michael, XK as in King, 569. If that's your vehicle and you're parked where the bookmobile and all the pylons are parked, you're illegally parked. If you don't move your vehicle, you'll be towed. So this is your last warning. Thank you for letting me interrupt.
Okay. Anybody got a silver Tempo out there? At any rate, the books are the books, and they're highly edited books because they were written for middle-class white audiences. And the ethnographies were taken by Clark Whistler and other people back then around the turn of the century, unfortunately, have never been popularized. They're hard to find and read, and they're quite very useful documents because they were literal. They weren't edited. But in addition to that, of course, we have the living tradition, which many people have thought the living tradition died 100 years ago, but indeed among the holy people and the elders, this tradition continues today. So that Joe and Josephine Croshaw, the holy people from the Pig Iron Reserve, recall traditions exactly as they were told to Clark Whistler and the other ethnologists over 100 years, well, not quite 100 years ago, 93 years ago, in great detail. Because in a society which doesn't write things down, everything is passed down orally and recalled and passed down through time. Now, many of us have a problem with this because we write everything down. But in oral societies, no matter where you are in the world, these traditions go back a very long time. So I want to talk about, is this landscape that was created? It combines rivers. And you can make a map of it. Don't pay attention to the details. There's no white man's names on this. They're all Blackfoot names. But essentially up at the north, we have the Bow River. And the things which are in yellow or pink refer to sacred visions, events which are founding events in terms of religious traditions. If they're yellow, they happened around 1,000 years ago. If they're pink, they happened before 1,000 years ago. And we're going to look at four areas. The Bow River, the Sweetgrass Hills, the Buffalo Jump, and the Porcupine Hills, and the Rocky Mountains. We're going to look at some aspects of their religion in terms of not of different features of the religion, but where the visions happen. Because in all religions, no matter whether traditional religions of tribal peoples or religions of urban civilizations like our religions are all founded on vision. Things happened in the past in certain places and gave to the people very important things. So I'm going to look at one of the very important aspects of these, the sacred bundles, and some of these. The Blackfoot people are known among all the native people of the Americas as having the most complex religion based on sacred bundles. That is, a bundle is a term which I guess can best be put is a number of sacred objects which are wrapped up, put together in a bundle. It's no different than you find in Catholicism among Mediterranean peoples where you put the saints' objects in the cathedral or wherever as a group of sacred objects. And they were known for having a large number of bundles that related to all kinds of different aspects of their religious society, including, which I don't have on this list, personal bundles. So we're going to take a little trip through our landscape and see where some of these things happen. The first place we're going to is out on the Bow River. And this is a place below the Blackfeet Reserve, where the tobacco garden, sacred tobacco garden, still is today, where the visioning of the Aniskum, or the buffalo stone, happened. The Aniskum, as some of you may know, is the buffalo stone. The event happened here, a place called the Falling Off Without Excuse, which was told to Clark Whistler by a Pigan elder in 1905. And he said the place this happened was up on the Bow River in Canada, at a place on the elbow, below the elbow on the other side is where the Bassano Dam is today, the place of Falling Off Without Excuse. And the story as it goes is that during the winter, the people were very hungry, the buffalo hadn't come, and a woman went out to collect firewood along the river, and she heard something singing to her. She was gone for 4 days and 4 nights. Now, 4 is the sacred number. in Blackfoot and many other Native people's traditions. And she received a vision from this thing, this Aniskum, which was calling to her. The Aniskum taught her songs which would call the buffalo. And then she went back with this and gave it to the people. And the people were successful in the buffalo drive. And this is the place where it happened. You might say, how do I know? The reason I know is not it's just a combination of the oral tradition, which didn't say just where the place was, but this is the place where the fossils, which when properly blessed by a medicine person become the Aniskum, this is a place where the outcrop on the Bow River. It's called by the fossil collectors Ammonite Beach. It simply rains ammonites, or did, until it got over-collected. And it's the last place in the Bow River where these outcrop. We can date this event, and this is very important in working out a chronology of how things happen in the past, at least to a historical perspective. Far distant from this, a little dot you can't really see, but a little thing there in the middle, is a sacred medicine circle. I use the name medicine circles instead of medicine wheels because the wheel was unknown to Native people of the Americas. And the circle, of course, is sacred. This is known as the medicine wheel. We call it the Majorville medicine wheel. I've found no name for this among the Blackfoot people. The elders up at Sitsika know of this place, as do some of the elders down here. I've talked about it. They know the place up there, but they don't have a name for it. I think the reason they don't have a name for it because it's like the buffalo jump. It's the place. It's where something very important happened in the past. And it's about 2 miles from the falling off without excuse where the sacred vision happened. Back in the early 70s, archaeologists carried out an excavation at this site. At least I don't dig these anymore because these are sacred sites and it's inappropriate to go around digging up sacred sites as far as I'm concerned. But back then we were kind of ignorant of these things and we thought it was fair game to go around doing this. And this site had never been vandalized. There's thousands of offerings in these large cairns that go in the medicine circles. And unfortunately, this has been on a ranch, the LK Ranch, since the 1880s, and had never been vandalized by pot hunters and treasure seekers and collectors. The archaeologists who dug this found that as they went into the center of this cairn, which is about 12 feet in diameter and about 6 feet high, he went through layers and layers of rock and artifacts. I think he has 10,000 artifacts. And he got back to the beginning. And think about this for a minute. In the beginning, he found at the bottom of all this, he found a flat fire-burned area, which we now know as an earth altar, a sacred altar, where something was sacrificed. He found some charcoal, some artifacts. And he got a date, a radiocarbon date on these materials. And they came out to be 5,500 years old. So this thing began 5,500 years ago. And what he found in the latest layers in it that dated to about 1,000 years ago, he found these. And these are Aniskums. They were covered with red ochre. They were covered with grease, the way they're properly handled. And the archaeologists concluded that these were bundles which had been placed back into the cairn. In traditional Blackfoot religion, you offer your bundles back. In some cases, you have a vision, you're instructed to do so. You offer them back to where they came from. If they come from the underwater people, they go back into the rivers or lakes or streams. If they come from the up above people, they go back up into trees. And they come from the ground people, they go into cairns. And what he found also were a number of bones of sacred animals, which were covered with ochre. And as I say, he concluded these were bundles. They appear 1,000 years ago. Accompanying these are pipes. Prior to that, we see neither Aniskums nor the pipe in here. So we can conclude that the vision of the woman, who we know the story, we know the name, we know her husband, we know what all the things that transpired, happened here on the Bow River about 1,000 years ago and had a very profound effect on their religion. Indeed, they were known, anthropologists talk about the Blackfoot people as being the people of the Buffalo Stone. Compared to other tribes. We also have many accounts of the visioning of the sacred teepees or the painted teepees. There are at least 150 of these designs, which are traditional. They're still, as they should be, visioned today. and their vision of these go back far distant in the past. There are two kinds of these. One we call flag teepees, which have the flags of the sacred animals, often or an otter, and both flying from the top of the teepee, or Aniskum teepees, which have Aniskums in their bundles, the teepee bundles. And this is where we have an account of the visioning of two of the Aniskum teepees, the two Aniskum teepees. In this account, two old men, and this is another very important vision, just like the woman's vision. A woman's vision is very important because we have very few accounts of women in Blackfoot religion having visions, at least that have been shared with white people. But this was a vision shared by two old men, and it was a waking vision rather than a dreaming vision. And they're well known, their names are known. And they went over to cut down some red willows somewhere along the Bow River in this area. And they sat on top of the bank, and they looked down into the river, and they saw a teepee. And one old man drove down, and he was gone for a long time, and he came back with this design. The other old man sat there for a while, and he saw another teepee. So he dove down and came back with this design. I'm sure many of you have seen both of these teepees. They're still both passed down today, traditionally, between the families who are associated with these. We have an account of how the Aniskums, the buffalo stones, got transferred into these teepees and how the people who visioned these transferred things that they had into other bundles. So this event happened, again, on the Bow River, perhaps around 1,000 years ago at this place or near this place. So we have that place, a very important place that's not being adequately protected. Further up the Bow River, where you get into the big cottonwood groves on today's Sika Nation, we have a number of accounts of sacred events, the visioning of various teepees, otter teepees. But the thing that's very important up there is the visioning of associated with the bringing of the tobacco and the pipe to the people, where the sacred tobacco garden was is located. And this relates to two of the basic tribal ceremonies of the people, which are the tobacco planting dance, which is no longer danced, and the sun dance, as we know it, or properly known as the Okan or Medicine Lodge ceremony. And the first of these that I have here is this one, the tobacco dance. The last dance was performed in the 1930s, and it happened here at the Sacred Tobacco Garden, down here in the bottoms of the Bow River. And here the people brought the tobacco to the people and brought the pipe to the people and taught the people how to grow and look after the tobacco plots. Associated with this are Aniskums. And Aniskums were very important in the whole tobacco dance ceremony. They would be laid out in the fields surrounding the tobacco plants during the summer by the beaver bundle, beaver men, owners, and then gathered back when they went back to harvest the sacred tobacco in the fall. This tobacco was used to wrap the pipes, to feed the pipes, as the old men say. It wasn't used for smoking. So this is the place where this happened, probably around 1,000 years ago. But that's not the only place up in Sitsika that's very sacred and important. Another place is Blackfoot Crossing, as we call it today, or the ridge underwater. I don't use the Blackfoot names because I was told by an elder, you white people are always going to pronounce it wrong, and somebody's going to laugh at you. So I'll stay with the English. But this place, the ridge underwater, interestingly enough, even though among most people today it's known because of the signing of Treaty 7 by Chief Crowfoot and the other chiefs of the Blackfoot, its history goes back thousands of years, and we have an account that's remembered, not so well today, but back in the 1930s and before, about a battle that happened here between the Blackfoot people and the Snake people. And one of the owners of the beaver bundles was very instrumental in helping the Blackfoot people to win the battle and defeat the Snake people. And the Snake people were Sioux people from the east, not Shoshone people, as we've misinterpreted as white historians. And so this is a very important place. It goes way, way back in Blackfoot tradition, and was used traditionally as a Okan or Medicine Lodge Sundance area by the Sitsika people, both before and after the confinement of the peoples to the reservations. So a very beautiful part of the province where many things happen. The other area I want to talk about, or the next area, is the Porcupine Hills or the Porcupine Mountains. And the place called Pishkin or Buffalo Jump, the Buffalo Jump, the first Buffalo Jump. It's where the people learn how to jump buffaloes. Here we have visioning of teepees and men's society bundles. So we're looking at this place, Pishkin. We have the visioning of one of the sacred teepees here. There were three sacred teepees associated with calling of the buffalo. The two Aniskum teepees I talked about before, the black and yellow Aniskum teepees, and another teepee called the Crow Lodge teepee, which was given to the people by the Crow. And the place this happened was at Crow Lodge Creek, which is on today's Pigan Reserve, right by the Buffalo Jump. And this account, again, has been passed down through many, many generations. And the story is that the people are starving, it's winter, there aren't any buffalo coming to the buffalo pound. So this man goes out towards the buffalo pound, and he meets up with some crows, or ravens, and he has a conversation with the ravens, and they strike a deal that the raven will show him how to do it, how to do the teepee design, which will help the people bring the buffalo to the Pishkin, if in turn that the people will always share with the ravens in the buffalo kill. So this is the place where the person came to, and this is the place where he received it from the crows, this teepee design here, which again is still passed down. And we have long genealogies for all these teepee designs, particularly these three that I've been working with. They go way back. You seem to know the first owners, everybody remembers the first owners of the teepees and the last owners of the teepees, and the people in the middle are not well remembered as to name. But something here that happened well over 1,000 years ago. At this place. The Buffalo Jump, I'm sure most of you have gone to it. Unfortunately, it got called Head Smashed In, and that's attributable to me, because as a naive archaeologist a long time ago, I asked, when I was digging there in the 60s, I knew there should be a traditional Blackfoot name for it, and I asked a historian for this name, and he gave me a name, and I said, all right, well, it sounds like it's probably the right name. And then when I was working with the Pagan elders back in the early 80s, I was being told by the old people that that's the wrong name in the Buffalo Jump, and getting chewed out by the elders, because I said, well, I'm the one who, you know, said this was the name, but I got it from somebody else, and they said, no, that's the wrong name. And the name of this place is Pishkin, the Buffalo Jump, not Head Smashed In. Head Smashed In is actually 20 miles north. It's west of, northwest of Stavely. Sorry, Granham. But it's here that one of the oldest of the men's societies was visioned. As some of you may know, the Blackfoot people are known for their very complex system of men's societies. Of the societies, the three elder societies were the Bulls, the Buffalo Catchers, and the Horn Society, which still continues today as a sacred men's society associated with the Okan and other religious activities. Preceding that, in terms of when the societies were visioned and established, are the Bulls and the Buffalo Catchers. The Buffalo Catchers were the people responsible for running the buffalo jumps, organizing the whole thing. And we have an account that comes down to us of how this happens. And this shows you how fragile the evidence is. This account's not remembered by the elders. I've showed the elders the account, and they remember bits and pieces of it. Because this society disappeared when the buffalo disappeared. The last time the bundle was probably open was in the 1860s. But in the 1920s, a collector, a buyer for a museum in New York, which has now been acquired by the Smithsonian, will be the National Museum of the American Indian on the Mall in D.C. This buyer, armed with wads of money, came out here to buy as many artifacts as he could from the Blackfoot and the Crow. He was out of Billings. And the bundle was still owned by an elder from the South Pagani, the Blackfeet. And for some reason, this white man, who was not an anthropologist, just a buyer, wrote down the story of how the vision occurred, because he never wrote anything else down. I don't know why he wrote it down. I've worked with his files in New York, and I can't find it, but he published it in a little article in 1923. And he said the place this happened was west of McLeod, Alberta, on the Old Man's River, where the Crow Lodge was visioned. at the Buffalo Jump. And we have a very detailed account of where and who that he happened, this guy's name was Wiltshut, happened to record. And this is the place where it happened. As the story goes, and again, this is oral history. These aren't fairy tales. This is literally what happened at some time in the past. They were camped below the Buffalo Jump for their fall Buffalo Jump, and a man had a vision. And in the vision, he came up against the cliff, below the cliff, and he's with the buffalo people. And the buffalo people taught him a new way to help bring the buffalo to the people. And he went back and taught the people the songs, the dances, and put together the holy bundle that goes with this. And then he went up above the buffalo jump, and the Aniskum came to him, and he put the Aniskums in the bundle. So we know that this happened somewhere around 1,000 years ago or later. And this is how, we also have accounts of how the people called the buffalo before they used the Aniskum, and how the Aniskum got transferred in the buffalo calling ceremony. And all this happened at this place, according to the tradition. And up above the buffalo jump, very few people get to go, unfortunately. There are rock carvings and very wonderful sights up there that perhaps relate to these old, old traditions. We have an account of the pipe being placed in the bundle with the Aniskums. And when I was in New York, I asked Elder Joe Crowshoe if I could look at the bundle. And he said yes, he would be interested to see what I saw in the bundle. And I, unfortunately, being a good museum, they had taken the pipe away from the pipe stand and put the pipe in the pipe collection, right? Because pipes belong in pipe collections, not with the rest of the sacred objects. And I was particularly interested in looking at the pipe because a number of the Blackfoot pipes are in fact carved out of Aniskums, because the pipe, traditional Blackfoot pipestone comes out of the same formation as do the sacred, what become the sacred Aniskums. So I didn't get to see the pipe bowl, but I saw the pipe stem. And the curator at the museum had never seen this bundle, its parts, before, and he looked at the pipe stem. And on the pipe stem, there was a number of little Aniskums, and there was a horse hairlock. And he said, that has to be very, very sacred, that horse hairlock. He says, I bet you that was the first horse the people ever saw. And we looked at the fire tongs, which are used in taking the coals out of the fire to do the smudge on the altar. And we counted the notches in the fire tongs. There was 480 notches. This bundle was only open once a year. So the fire tongs that went with that were 480 years old. And so it's a very, very interesting one. I hope that it can get returned to where it belongs eventually, to the Buffalo Jump. So from here, we move on to the third place, the Rocky Mountains. And at that point, we have to change the slides. So what this does is, I hope I've given you a sense of how the landscape is integrated through sacred visions, how it becomes a whole, and how this takes has gone on for a long time. Yeah, our usual glitches. We lost a slide. You mean the changer won't work? All right, modern technology goes together to put things together. One of the interesting things in this kind of work is, I was talking to a Crow medicine man about this, and a Northern Cheyenne person by the name of Bill Talbot, about these places, which among the traditional people in the Northern Plains are still there. And I said, well, you know, are the spirits still there? Because that's a question I often get asked when I'm doing a little interpretive hikes and talks. You know, are the spirits of this land still there? And the old men say yes, they're still there. And of course, as you know, Chief Mountain, or Ninistakis, an event happened on that mountain this summer, which happened because that was the time it was to happen. geologically and scientifically. It could have happened. It could have happened the year before, but it happened this summer. And there were very good reasons for it, but that's another talk. We want to cut the lights, so continue. So ahead from the Buffalo Jump, not that many crow miles southwest, to Mystacus, or the backbone. The reason it's the backbone, because it is the backbone. Not only does it look like a backbone when you go into the heart of it, but it's the place where many very important things happened as well. And this is just a little close-up of it. I'm going to talk about Ninistocus, or Ninistocus, Chief Mountain, as is known to us, and what happened there, and what happened at a little lake west there, which is one of the name, Blackfoot names for it, is the lake that never stops moving, which you all know which one that is. But I want to talk about vision questing and its association with the Rocky Mountains. And I'm glad to see that John Dormar is here, and John knows much more about this than I do, and has been involved in finding many of these sites over the last 30 or so years. Traditionally among Blackfoot people, both the men and women, although I know very little about the women's tradition, you went on, as a young person, a vision quest. You went on a quest to acquire your sacred power, to put together your medicine bundle, to be empowered as a person. And this is a tradition that's found around the world by many, many tribal people. We have our own rites of passage in our religions as well. Traditionally, you would go up into a place that was high and isolated, up on top of the hill in the prairies, or out in the coulees around here in Lethbridge, and fast for 4 days and 4 nights. And on the fourth night, your spirit person would come to you and empower you. What we find is that these places are only in certain places, and in the mountains, they associate with the sacred peaks, principally Ninistocus, or Chief Mountain. I just want to show you some of the sites which are up there, give you some idea of it. Some of the early white ethnologists said that some of these were in high and difficult places. Indeed, some of them are in very high and difficult places. But this isn't one. This is in Waterton, on top of Sofa Mountain. It's used today by Kainai people. There's a little offering in the center of the structure there, sweet grass and some tobacco, traditional offerings, and it faces right at Chief Mountain. If we go west into Waterton Park, up above Crandall Mountain there, right on the top, you look down on the bottom of the slide, there's another little structure. You can see that across the landscape, coming up between two of the peaks, is Chief Mountain. They're always consistently sighted where you can see the sacred peak. And here's a view of the structure. Even though many climbers have climbed up there over the years, fortunately this one has not been too badly disturbed by people. A little bed, a little defined area where you would sit and wait and sing and pray for your 4 days. They go much further west, looking up to the head of Red Rock Canyon, looking down from Goat Lake. Think of that point out there. It's about a 1,000-foot drop on all sides, not quite all sides, but then you get out on the point, there's the remains of a little structure there. It doesn't show up well here. It's in volcanic rock. And here's one of the viewpoints. That's Goat Lake. Look from the top. It's not very large, not a lot of area to sit there, but it's a place that was used for vision questing. And you can see Chief Mountain from it. Up above it on the higher ridge, at about 8,400 feet or so, there's another platform. You have three kinds, little beds, or dream beds as we call them, or prayer platforms, which are just oval, circular platforms of flagstones, or just two or three rocks piled up to commemorate the place. If you look real hard through the smog, you can see that Chief Mountain is back there. It's really hard to see, but you can see it, and it's only along this ridge in this place where you really can see the mountain. And here's a view of the structure. Now this is very high. If you look at the structure, you can see there's a large number of lichens growing on it, black lichens. And lichens at that altitude grow very, very slowly. And John and I think that many of these structures are thousands of years old, simply because of the growth of the lichens that are on them. So you get them up to at least 18 miles away along the Continental Divide, looking through the mountains at Ninistocus, the sacred mountain. You also have many kinds of activities vision questing, and other religious activities associated with the mountain today and in the past. I just want to take you on a quick tour around the mountain. Up to the top first. The top is, sacred mountains are very interesting places because those mountains which are sacred, like Mount Sinai to us in our tradition, or Fuji, or other ones which are sacred to the Buddhist people and the Hindu people, they all have a number of very similar characteristics, and I won't go into them, but one of the interesting things about this mountain in particular is that in one aspect, the mountain's very solid. It's very massive. In another aspect, it's very spiritual. It's very ephemeral. And certainly you get that impression when you're on top of it. Here you are on the top. We have the remains of about 5 vision quest structures. Traditionally, among the Blackfoot people in the past, and still today, this was the place where you would go when you wanted a lot of help, basically. And we have a number of accounts from the last century recorded by James Willard Schultz and Blackfeet elders in Montana about vision questing up on the mountain. And traditionally, you would take a buffalo skull for your pillow, along with your pipe and your robe, and you'd leave the skull behind. The first white person to climb the mountain, which in the hiking books, of course, is recorded as the first person to climb the mountain, was a fellow by the name of Henry Stimson, who went on to be the Secretary of War under the Roosevelt administration, Teddy Roosevelt. And he climbed it in the late 1890s. And when he got on top with his Blackfoot guide, he found a buffalo skull. And the guide told him the story about why the skull was there and why people used the mountain. And Stimson wrote this down. He was one of the founders of the Boone and Crockett Club. And he left it there. He knew the importance of these things. And then some years later, I think about 1911, he came back with his niece to climb the mountain for the second time. And they camped on Kennedy's Creek up above Chief Mountain Junction. And when they rode into their camp, they met two young Methodist missionaries who had been missionizing among the Kainai people, the blood people. And they're on their way back to the eastern U.S. And they had a buffalo skull with them. And Stimson said, well, where'd you get this buffalo skull? And the young man said, well, I've picked this up on top of the mountain. Isn't it neat? I'm going to take it home to Pennsylvania or New York City and stick it on my fireplace. And Stimson told him the story. And the young man said, well, you know, if I'd known this, I wouldn't have taken that. He says, here, you take it and put it back. So Stimson took the buffalo skull and his niece, and he climbed the mountain the next day, and he put it and buried it in a rock pile so nobody would take it again. The last record I have of one of the ancient buffalo skulls being taken off the mountain was in the late 1960s or early 70s when a lady told me she had climbed the mountain with a group of people, gotten off the trail and found a buffalo skull and taken it back, and it hangs in a rec room in this city. Stimson made the very interesting remark, and he left it at that point. He says, you know, if I'd been 10 minutes earlier or 10 minutes later, we'd never have met. Isn't that strange? But of course, in Native tradition, it isn't strange because it was meant to happen. It was to go back on top of the mountain. So we have the remains of a number of structures along the top of the peak. Here's a modern one today. As I say, this is an ongoing tradition, thousands of years old. And this structure, to give you some idea of size, is just big enough to sit in. Just a little over a meter in diameter, and the drop is a vertical 1,000 feet on 3 of the 4 sides. So you have vision questing, because this is the place that the most powerful up above people, the spirit people who live in the up above place, live. It's a place, therefore, that you have other things happening as well as the vision questing, and return to those places for spiritual purposes. And one of the most fundamental of these is the visioning of the longtime pipe, the first of the medicine pipe bundles. This pipe today is currently cared for by George Kickingwoman, who's an elder medicine person from Browning, Montana. And it has been traded back, or I should say transferred back and forth between different elders down through the generations. And the account we have about the vision of the pipe relates to this mountain. And this account relates that this is the place for thunder, the thunderbird. lives, the being who makes the spring rain come. And the story relates to a young man who's in a camp on the St. Mary's River Valley, and he becomes curious about the mountain. And he talks to his father, and his father says, well, you know, it's a very powerful place. And he goes up there on a vision quest. He goes up to the foot of the mountain, and as he goes up, the clouds are gathering, and he gets up there, and all of a sudden he's inside the Thunderbird's cave. And the Thunderbird teaches him, gives him the knowledge, and he comes back with the thunder, with the pipe to the people. Somewhere up on the front face is where it happened. And he brings back the pipe to the people, and this is the tradition of the medicine pipe bundles. This event probably happened, as best as I can reckon, the way I would think as a historian, certainly more than 3,000 years ago, and perhaps as far back as perhaps 5,000 years ago, a very long time ago, because the traditions in the medicine pipe bundles are quite different than other traditions within the religion. So you have that event. You have many other accounts of vision questing and activities going on the mountain. You have some spurious accounts too, which were written by, I thought at one time it was written by James Willard Schultz to entertain the tourists. Louis Hill used to hire him at East Glacier Lodge when he was sober enough, which wasn't very often, to entertain the tourists when they came off the train, and Schultz cooked up a number of Indian stories about Glacier, as well as naming many mountains as well. With Blackfoot names which have absolutely are not authentic at all. And I thought this one particular account was one of Schultz's, but I found it was cooked up by two women who wrote a guidebook, no gender insult intended, but in about 1912 to Glacier, and they wanted to make it more attractive for the tourists going around Glacier Park, so they cooked up a very fanciful story about the mountain, which has no basis in fact. Today, of course, the traditions associated with the mountain continue. I'll just show you a few of the offerings which are left there. The bolts of sacred cloth, or we call them ribbon sites or tie sites, both around the base, up at the base of the mountain as well as further down. The traditional offerings. Offerings of tobacco, usually sweet grass, usually a few other things as well, in the traditional sacred colors. The Horn Society, members of the Horn Society also go up there. These are some of their little ceremonial staffs in the trees, which were left up there in the early 70s. What's happened, fortunately, around the base in the last 2 years, I've been working with the Blackfeet tribe in Montana in monitoring use of the site by white people or hikers of all kinds, is that so many people have been coming in there that last summer we actually saw for the first time offerings being taken. And these were well documented. They disappeared over Labor Day weekend. Three tobacco ties that were lifted right off the trees and disappeared. So the Blackfeet tribe last fall passed a tribal resolution saying, please walk up if you're going to go up through the reservation. And other offerings as well. They're not only there, but they're up in the boulder field below the mountain. This is a traditional Blackfoot cross erected last summer. These are before the mountain fell down. Offerings here. Part of this offering was thieved over the winter. It's a Pekani or Blackfoot cross on the right, the eagle feathers, red, and on the left there was a blanket and a pair of beautiful beaded moccasins. They just, by the spring when I went back up there, they had gone. Somebody presumably had taken them. And another offering left around the corner of Pecani Cross and a nice little pair of moccasins. I know something about the background of this one. It's still there. We also see a little bit of pictographs or carvings in art up there. None of it's very ancient in the bottom. There may be some very old rock carvings on the top, but you do see these around the bottom of the mountain. And then on the back, as you go around to the back to where you climb up the back, there's offering sites there as well. As I say, unfortunately, many of these, or some of these, have been vandalized by people who I think don't really know what they're about, but they think it's interesting, and just like the buffalo skulls, they took them home. Fortunately, with the mountain falling down on July 2nd and sending a message to all kinds of people, including the Bureau of Indian Affairs, who then closed the road permanently, I'm happy to report that between July 2nd, when somebody put a new log on top of the mountain just before it fell down, and September 15th, when I was up there, only 6 people had registered in the log. Last summer, between the middle of the first weekend in August and the same weekend in September, we had 60 registrants in the log. So people are not going up there anymore, because you have to walk a few more miles through the park. So on the top, there are also many offerings. Many of these pass out of the record quite quickly because they don't translate into things that an archaeologist would find. But we do know the structures go back a long way. This is a view along the top this fall after the rock fall. A number of things have fallen down. There's a big crack opened up. But this was placed up there this summer. Very beautiful offering. So this mountain is of very central importance to the people. It's one of the great places that we have within North America, in Western North America. Well, let's move a little bit west to the lake that never stops moving, this place, which I think has been moving a lot the last couple of weeks. But this is, as you would think, a very important place as well. We often think of the Blackfoot people as being plains people. And this is a myth that's been mainly created by white writers, historians, ethnologists, and others. But in fact, there are people not only of the plains, but of the foothills and the mountain front. The mountains, that was very part and the very core of their sacred territory, their sacred geography. So that in this place, we have visioning of sacred teepees. Here's where one was visioned. Down here, right near the registration office. This is the teepee. I don't have a picture of that particular teepee cover. But this, the teepee that was visioned there was one of the yellow otter teepees. And this is the only place where the otters are whenever they do happen to come back into the Waterton area. But the thing that we have that's visioned here, which is very, very fundamental to the Blackfoot religion, is the beaver bundle, or the preserving pelt bundle. This bundle, according to tradition, which is well remembered today, was visioned in this lake here. It was visioned by the first Piegan, first Piconi, Apiconi. And the story goes that Apiconi was invited to spend the winter with the beaver people. He entered into the chief beaver's lodge. He spent the winter there. And during the winter, he learned many wonderful things. He learned all about the world, learned all about the plants and the animals as time went on. And the wind blew, and things happened. And as spring came, and he began to acquire all his knowledge, the chief beaver instructed him to take it back to the people. So with the coming of spring, he came back to his people and gave them the beaver bundle, which I like to use the comparison, and I apologize for any of the native people here if this is a wrong comparison. The beaver bundle to me is like taking all of Christian tradition and wrapping it up in one thing. It's the Old and New Testament and a whole bunch of all things all put together. And this is what it is. And that's the place where it happened. We have accounts of the first owners and the last owners and the people in the middle. And adding up all the genealogies, I come up with a date of about 2,000 years ago. We have accounts of how the Inniskums got put in the beaver bundle and who put them in and where they were in the genealogy of the owners. And we know when that happened about 1,000 years ago. So this is a very, very ancient and fundamental vision to the people. The second vision, which is fundamental to the people and to the Okan and the medicine lodge, is the Natoas bundle, or the Holy Woman's headdress. The Holy Woman, as some of you know, is the principal person during the Okan or Medicine Lodge. And this, again, is very important because this is a woman's vision. And this is a traveling vision. It's one of the two traveling visions I'll be talking about. The second one is the Scarface vision, which is also part of the Okan. Other visions happen in one place I've told you about. This woman goes on a journey. And this journey begins somewhere in the south, up here in this country. This is the Carbondale River. No, Castle, whichever, one of the two. And it's interesting because the accounts that ethnologists recorded, because this was a woman's story, they were rather abbreviated because, of course, men talk to men. And we have a very bad gender bias in our understanding of Native culture as well as Native religion because of that. And I happened to be talking to Josephine Crochu a couple of years ago in the winter, and we were just having tea and talking. And she's a holy woman, and she decided to tell me the story that she'd been told by her grandmother. So she gave me this very detailed account. I said, well, that, you know, and we talked a bit. And I'd never heard this account in this detail before. It'd always been kind of abbreviated. So I went back and searched through my accounts and my texts. And sure enough, I found that a Dutch linguist by the name of Uhlenbeck, who was here before the First War, had recorded the same account in the same detail from a very distant, well, not actually not so distant, but a great aunt of Josephine's. And she had gotten it down and in the great detail. And in this account, the vision starts here. And the woman starts traveling north. She goes to this country, which we'll never see again. This was another sacred place within that reservoir, where there are eagle trapping pits, there's sacred teepees came out of this, Horseshoe Canyon, and other things happened. And went on further up the Old Man's River, went behind the Porcupine Hills, and when all was done, she ended on the Red Deer's River, the Elk's River. And in her vision, at the end, the elk comes to her, and the elk gives her various things, which she puts together to make the holy woman's headdress, which is fundamental to the Okan or Medicine Lodge ceremonies. The other one is a traveling vision, and this is the Scarface story. And this associates with the Sweat Lodge and the Sundance, or the Okan. It's a multiple vision. It's a multiply layered story. The basics are very, very ancient. As archaeologists, I know that the use of the Sweat Lodge by the people here goes back 5,000 years. We used to dig them up and call them plant roasting pits or ovens, but we never found any food remains in them. And we were really surprised about what these were. And then I was privileged to have a sweat with Joe Crochu. And I was having a sweat in the lodge a few years ago and sitting there, and here came in the same rocks I've been digging up over the years, the same size pit, and everything was exactly the same as one I dug up in the Old Man River Dam reservoir, as a matter of fact, some time before. So that's how I came to know about those things and what they are. But we have a story of how the Sweat Lodge first came to the people, and then how this gets interlayered with the other aspects of what becomes the Sundance or the Medicine Lodge. And this is a Scarface story, one that probably many of you are familiar with. A young Blackfoot Piegan person, they're camped out around the Sweet Pine Hills, and this person has a disfiguring scar, and he's rejected by a young woman he's very much enamored with. And he goes to an elder medicine person, and the elder says, you're going to have to seek help. So he begins his vision quest. He begins it on the East Butte of the Sweet Pine Hills, and there the person of that place says, you have to go west. So he starts here. His first journey is not too far west. He goes past Gold Butte into the West Buttes, up on top of this place. And the person of that place says, well, I can't help you, but you must keep going west, traveling west. He says, go to the person of the place of the first mountain you meet going west. And we all know what mountain that is, this mountain. So the young man goes up on top of this mountain, and now things are getting quite difficult. The first two visions, things are not too difficult. The visions come to him. There's not a lot of trouble, not a lot of problems. Spirits don't try to throw him out of his place where he is, and it's easy. But here on the top of this place, it becomes difficult. Things come at him during the 4 days and four nights that he's up there. And he has trouble, but he sees the sacred place he came from, the Sweet Pine Hills to the east. And he takes heart in that. And on the fourth night, the person in that place comes to him. And he says, or the person in that place says, you must go on west and travel west across the mountains. to the highest mountain of them all. So Scarface heads west across the lakes, through the mountains, through the interior mountains, across the great rivers. And he comes to one of these mountains here. I don't happen to have a picture of Mount Rainier, which is probably the mountain. But this is one of the other mountains, the volcanoes in the Cascade Range. And after a great deal of difficulty in ascending the top of the mountain, which any of you who climb or know how difficult it is to get up those volcanic peaks and how wet and dangerous they are, and after having a very difficult vision for 4 days and four nights on top of the mountain, the person at that place says, "You must go to the Great Lake on the west and wait there." So Scarface travels to the shore of the ocean, and there he waits. And eventually, he's taken across the ocean to the Sun's Lodge, someplace far to the west, or far somewhere. And in the Sun's Lodge, he goes through a number of trials and helps the Sun's son, and I won't go into the story. But at any rate, the Sun cures him in the Sun's Lodge, and the Sun's Lodge is a sweat lodge. So he brings this back to the people as a gift from the Sun, back to the Sweet Pine Hills where he began, and gives it to the people. And this original founding vision happened in the very long, long ago, I say perhaps 5,000 years ago, because that's when we as archaeologists see these sweats first appearing in the record. And it's fundamental to sweats, of course, are fundamental to Blackfoot religion. Before any ritualist or other people can open bundles or do holy activities, you must have a sweat. And this is the basis for it. But the Sweet Pine Hills has many sacred things about it. And probably you've seen the press on the finding of the gorgets, the shell masks, as they're called, or the pendants, the knot masks, that were found there this fall, or this summer, August. And these relate to later things that go on. I talked to some of the elders recently at a conference in Montana, North Cheyenne and Crow people and others, about what they remembered. They recalled from their own traditions, which are not written down, recorded, about what the Sweet Pine Hills meant to them. And they lived a fair long ways away. And they said, well, this is a very sacred place. This happened. We know about this. We got our sweet pine from there. So there are many traditions among the Plains tribes about this place. And it's part of the traditional Blackfoot area and sacred places. And later here we have accounts which interlay with the early Sweat Lodge account, which eventually end up in the Medicine Lodge or the Sundance Ceremony, in which the sweat is an integral part of it. And traditionally among the Blackfoot, the sweat lodge that goes with the Okan is the 100 Willow Sweat Lodge. The other sweat lodge is 14 Willow, and it has 100 rocks in it. So we have accounts of how this happens to be a Kootenai, Sundance site from the Kootenai Plains. We also have traditions of how the Sundance got given to the other people by the Blackfoot, the Cree and the Kootenai. And of course, accounts that associate with this, and this is one of the traditional Sundance sites on the Blackfoot Reserve at Blackfoot Crossing, just after the signing of Treaty 7. So again, this is part of how it all gets put together, how the landscape gets created. You have visions, traveling visions, you have visions in one place of how things all got stitched together and made a sacred landscape. I could go on and talk about sacred ecology, of how the plants and animals all integrate into this, but that's another layer of knowledge, of how it all works together. And it all works, of course, to make sure that your traditional world continues as it is. You've put together sacred special mountains, which have very special features, visioning as a basis for religious tradition, no matter whose religion it happens to be. You integrate a prairie plains landscape with a mountain landscape, with sacred and most sacred of all peaks. You integrate rivers and the underwater people, the visioning of the Inniskum, the Buffalo Stone Teepees, places such as Badger Creek down on the Blackfeet Reserve, which I haven't talked about, associations with it, which are very important as well. Places such as Buffalo Stone Lake, which is down in the Blackfeet Reserve, which we also have visions that go with it. And places such as the lake that never stops moving, where we have, again, a very focal vision the beaver bundle. And human places, not just natural places, but also places which are slightly different, such as the buffalo jump, where not only were people taught to hunt buffalo by Napi, the creator, but also where the Crow Lodge teepee was visioned and where the Buffalo Catcher Society was visioned. And places such as the Medicine Circle out in the Bow. Why did people come here 5,500 years ago and start this? Did somebody have a vision that 4,000 years later there'd be another vision at this place and they had to start it then? Because in non-traditional thought, this happens. The past, present, and future are not separate as we separate it in the way we think as Western people. Perhaps this is the case. So it all comes together. And I think for me, as having been born in Lethbridge, but fortunately lived in Waterton, and as a newcomer here, my grandmother came in 87, which is not very long ago. This gives an added meaning to me as a person who resides and lives in this place and very much loves it. And it gives a sense of how important this is to the Blackfoot people and was for thousands of years. This doesn't happen overnight. It takes a long, long time to build up this intimate association with the landscape and the plants and animals and the other than human beings that populate it so that you get a very strong religious tradition that puts it all together. Thank you. We have some lights. Anybody has any questions, I'll be glad to answer questions.
Could you give us the details of how the Indians knew there was going to be an event last year on Chief Mountain? Are there traditions?
There's traditions, yes, about the mountain. I'll give you one account. I just recently came across. This was recorded by George Bird Grinnell in 1887 when he was hunting sheep at St. Mary's, well, the Inside Lakes, which is the right name for St. Mary's Lakes. And he was talking to James Willard Schultz, who had told him a story that an old Blackfeet elder had told him about Chief Mountain. And it was a prophecy about the mountain falling down at that time and the end of the traditional way of life. So these traditions go back a long way, just like the elders that I talked to after this happened, when they asked me to look at the mountain for them. They'd had dreams that this was going to happen. They were very concerned about the offerings being vandalized, about people using the place inappropriately and not with respect. The elders I've talked to don't have a problem with white people going up there, but doing things properly, just like we, when we go into our own churches, there's ways you do things to avoid offending the person of that place. It could have fallen down last year. We had heavy rains. The conditions are right for that mountain to fall at just about any time. But this year we had heavy rains, and the scientific explanation, we had the heavy rains and an earthquake, and that's why it slipped. But could have been last year, but this year was the year for it to do it.
Was there a lot of destruction through the earthquake?
It's the largest geological event that's happened on the mountain in over 1,000 years. It's very massive. It's not the largest one that ever happened. There's probably one that happened maybe, a long time ago. There was a huge slide that happened on the east side a very, very long time ago. But then certainly in the last 1,000 years, this is the largest slide that's happened there. It got within less than 1 mile of the highway in terms of the mud flows and removed. All the offering sites have been removed that are up in the boulder field. Everything is gone. Yes?
Proceed to the time when y'all shut down Chief Mountain. I heard
What we have to do is back up a little bit. Half the mountain, as you know, is in Glacier National Park, and half is on the Blackfeet Reserve. The reason for this is that in 1896, the Blackfeet tribe was persuaded by the U.S. government to sell that worthless piece of strip, the mountains. Because the usual thing was, they were saying, well, you know, you have to be self-sufficient, we can't afford to feed you anymore, you got all these mountains here, you don't need them anyways, there happens to be some copper strikes up there, and, you know, why don't you just sell it back to us? So that became the Lewis and Clark National Forest in 1896. And then that part of the Lewis and Clark National Forest north of Highway 2, the Marias Pass, became Glacier National Park in 1912. That's why, and when they laid it out, they just simply went from point to point. So half the mountain is in the park and half the mountain is on the reservation. Until the Chief Mountain Highway was built in the 30s, everybody, traditionalists as well as white people who climbed it, didn't access it from the highway. They accessed it along the old trails up Lee Creek from the north or up Kennedy Creek from the east. Once they built the highway, hikers started to come in and climbers. But most of the old routes were, in fact, inside the park. In 1968, the Blackfeet Tribal Council had an oil well drilled very close to the base of the mountain, which cuts off 1 hour's hiking each way. And that oil well, that gas well, depending on where your perspective's of, was a dry hole. But the road wasn't reclaimed, so that allowed everybody very easy access through the reservation. Now, and as a result, the patterns have changed a lot through time. What I'm working with, the Blackfeet Tribe and the Park Service, U.S. National Park Service, Glacier Park, is looking at having the mountain designated as a National Historic Landmark under U.S. law. The Park Service is quite amenable to it. The traditional people on the tribe are quite amenable to it. And what that will allow is for the park to establish management guidelines which they can, in fact, restrict use to the mountain and control use to the mountain for climbers. And we're hopeful that it can be, that everybody can be accommodated, because the superintendent of Glacier said he'd like to give it back, but he can't, because, you know, that's the way it is. So this is probably the best compromise we'll come up with. I think a good solution will end up that a whole area will be set aside and managed. And anybody can climb it today. You just have to hike an extra 4 hours. That's all. And perhaps you should work a little harder getting up there. Yeah?
What is Heart Butte?
Heart Butte? Yes. It's another focal and sacred peak on the south end of the reservation. In the original name, the original Blackfoot names for this whole region, they only had two names. Was Ninistakis, Chief Mountain, and Heart Butte. That's the only two names that were on the mountains. James Willard Schultz asked a Pecani elder about the names of the mountains when he got there in 1883, and he said, well, that's the only two got names on them. He said it was rather foolish to name mountains after people, he thought, since mountains are mountains. Makes sense. Heart Butte, yes. Mm-hmm. I know that's the place where the sacred paint comes from. The locations are... I'm not sure if the locations are inside the forest reserve or outside the forest reserve. I can't recall if that's leased land or private land. I know where the place is. And the band of Pecani who have traditionally said that was their area. That's all I know about it. In fact, this is where the paint, the traditional source for the paint was, is, I should say.
What about the working
hills?
Are there sacred spots
there? Yes. As well as the Buffalo Jump, we have good accounts. Again, it's an area which traditionalists still use today, but we have good accounts going well back. About vision questing up there, and we have a number of vision quest structures along the hills. There's rock art sites, sacred sites up there in some of the buttes that have never been seen by anybody except the elders.
What about
Writing on Stone is part of the whole thing that goes together with the Sweetgrass Hills, or Sweet Pine Hills. Again, it's a traditional vision questing area. Most of that rock, what we call art, most of the rock art was probably executed as part of vision quests, except for some of the more, the scenes like the battle scenes, which are, you know, our accounts of historic events. But a lot of that art is related with visioning there. And I think there's a direct link between the hills and writing on stone. Again, this is an interesting thing because there's lots of sandstone in traditional Blackfoot territory, both in today's Alberta and northern Montana, where you can do rock art, particularly down in the Blackfeet Reservation. There's tons of cliffs, and there is no rock art at all except there. That's the only place, because that's the sacred place. Mm-hmm. Some more questions?
Dr. Reeves, speaking of geography, the sacred geography, how much is known of the movement of the Native people from Buffalo Jump to Buffalo Jump? Because there were a number of them, I understand. Did they go from place to place, or did you went just one jump area? Or how much is known about that thing?
You're right, there's many buffalo jumps, and the larger buffalo jumps all have traditional names with them. It would depend on where the buffaloes were at any particular winter, okay? And as archaeologists, all we can say is that a place like Hitzmashton or the buffalo jump has had essentially a continuous record of use for 3,000 years. We don't find significant breaks. But that's not meaning to say it was used every year, because the next one north is the Ghost Pound, or Stowey Pishkin, which is called Boneyard Coulee west of Stavely. And it was another major buffalo jump. The Old Woman's Buffalo Jump, which is another traditional buffalo jump, was a small one compared to the big ones. And there's big ones in Montana as well. So I think the best we can say is that depending if the buffalo went into that valley, that's where they'd be. And we don't know enough about the buffalo, we never will, basically. No, I don't, but there are some, I understand. Yes, I've been there.
Mm-hmm.
Any stories associated with Red Rock Coulee out on the flanks of the Cypress Hills? There are stories, but I'm not familiar with them. Yes?
I was wondering if you did any studying on the Medicine Circle on these
sides of the
reserves.
The memorial circles? I'm familiar with the ones that are on the north end.
Way by the cross kit.
Yes.
Have you studied
them? No. They're known whose memorial wheel or circle that is. That's we've used an unfortunate thing is that we've classified, I'm saying we as white archaeologists, have classified these all as medicine wheels. And when really there's a lot of different ones. There's the one kind which are the memorial wheels commemorate people in the place where they were buried. And they go back a long time. And then there's these big ones up on top of the hills like Sundial Butte here north of town, and the one up on the Bow, and a number of these, and there's other ones. There's a variety of these. But they serve different purposes. I do believe that. The big ones we don't know much about, but they're... They're really interesting. Some really interesting things up there.
Do you know how old it is?
Which one?
The one on the east, north end of the
Is that 1880s, Margaret?
Turn of the century.
Yeah. That's many spotted horses, isn't it? Yep. Only in the sense of what I've learned from writing and talking to people. That there's many of these. There's about 150 now have been recorded. As I said, some of them are very ancient, well over 1,000 years when they were visioned and been passed down. The stories are still there. intact. Ceremonies are still intact that go with the bundles. The earliest evidence we have of the use of teepees by the native people here is about 5,000 years ago. That's when we see our first teepee rings in our sites. And that's presumably that's when the teepee came to the people. Well, that's true and not true. There's a cemetery north of Swift Current, which has it's called the Gray Burial Site. And this cemetery dates between 5,500 and about 3,000 years ago. It was found during the 30s when the land was blowing out and the farmers started to plow up human bones. There were some studies carried out of this back in the 1960s. And they found the remains of over 300 individuals who had been buried there, including dogs as well, and a lot of ritual objects buried with the people. And it appears that these were nomadic people, there's no doubt about it. We know who they are culturally. We don't know who they were ethnically or linguistically. But they kept going back to that one place. So we do, in fact, have these rare places where people went back for whatever reason and buried their dead. But this is very unusual. These are the largest graveyards of their kind that have ever been found among nomadic peoples anywhere. They're bigger than anything in the Ukraine or anything. Normally, as I understand it, the place where you chose to be buried was very much an individual choice, as it would be among us if we were not forced to be buried in registered cemeteries. I recall an old-timer, Frenchie, who lived out at Pincher Creek, and some of you people might remember the story. Old Frenchie passed away some years ago, and he used to play at the Prince of Wales. He used to sit there and entertain the tourists as a Belgian count. He was from Belgium extract, and he wanted to be buried on his ranch in the head of Pincher Creek. And they had a very hard time of getting permission for him to be buried outside a designated graveyard. I think it took 3 weeks before he could be buried. But anyway, that's off the subject, but it's relevant. traditionally, and I don't know the Blackfoot pattern in that sense, but I have worked with Stoney elders in the case of before the Bighorn Reservoir was built. As we worked up there in the early 70s, and there was a concern among the Stoney elders about the burials that were located up there. And talking to the elders, that it could be where you may have passed away in your own cabin. It could be where you had a vision as a young person. It could have been a favorite hunting place, a place you liked to be, and so they were all over the place. And that's the pattern to them. There's no particular place that I know of, except when you get into where you're dealing with prominent medicine people and leaders of the society where they make these memorials. And they appear to associate with certain places. Yes? No, that's within the traditional Blackfoot territory. They're important as a place for lodge poles, a place for wintering, a place for sun dances. Before the people were confined to the reservations, the pattern that I seem to be able to put back together, and it's not very clear, is that the traditional places for sun dancing, the South Pekani traditionally and the Pekani traditionally had their sun dances out at the Sweet Pine Hills. The Kainai's traditional sun dance areas were out towards Medicine Hat, and the Tsitsika traditional areas were on the lower part of the Red Deer River. That's the best I can do with it. Now, I'm sure there's a number of cairns and effigies and medicine circles up in there, and I don't know, frankly, I do not know if there's any tradition among the Kainai people that may relate to those still. I mean, we have the visioning of the medicine man's bonnet at a Medicine Hat, for example, as a sacred vision that's with their traditions out there. I just don't know. I would hope there would be, but who knows. Basically, when you look at it, there isn't a real division between the north and south They seem to have had, from what I can tell, talking to some of the old people, that they had their sun dances were together, and it was after the reservation and the confinement to the reservations that they began to have their own sun dances. Before that, they had them together.
Arnie, can I just,
mm-hmm.
in case some people have to leave, and then we can carry on. In case some of you have to leave earlier, I'd just like to say a few words. I'm the retiring president of the Historical Society, and of all the years that I have been in that society, all the years I heard Jim Carpenter talk about this fellow Barney Reeves and Alec Johnson the same way, I never had the opportunity to meet him for one reason or another, but I always have heard of him. And I think now I, and likely all of you, have a certain kinship to Barney Reeves, Dr. Brian Reeves, I should really be calling him. But this kinship came to me this evening when he showed the pictures taken along the Bow River where the natives had been in the early years. And I was there in the early years because I was born and grew up in Calgary, and as a young boy, my dad used to take us out in the Model T, and we camped all the way from Gleeson in the east to Banff up in the west and farther on, all up and down the Bow and the Ghost Rivers, and later down into this country too on the Old Man. And I, as he was talking, could very easily get the vision that the natives must have had, and that I think Brian must have acquired quite a long time ago to direct him into this exciting archaeological study. So I had a great deal of appreciation for your presentation tonight, and I'm sure that those assembled here have too. I want to thank you all for coming. You know, we never quite know for sure exactly whether the hall is too big or not big enough, and fortunately tonight it wasn't big enough, and it's wonderful that you're all here and are supporting our efforts to make these annual series of lectures a success, and we hope that we carry on with the traditions that we've started in these first 3 years. We thank you all for coming tonight, and remember next year there'll be another lecture, and we'll let you know where and when it will be. So on behalf of the Friends of Alec Johnson, the University of Lethbridge, and the Lethbridge Historical Society, Brian, we thank you so much for your wonderful presentation.
Thank you, sir. If anybody wants to talk, I've had my car accident for the day, so. What'd you see up there?
Like what? Oh, thank you. It's a long story.
There, well, actually, really, I have some Kootenai traditions I'm just working on right now. I'm looking at some of that.
Uh-huh. Yeah. Hmm.